Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. This new podcast has been downloaded more than 1.5 million times over the last 5 months, thanks to listeners like you. Next week, we'll be launching season 2 of the podcast, bringing you more evidence and experience about a broader range of topics, including but not limited to COVID-19. This week, we're checking in with people we interviewed in some of our most powerful episodes from season 1. Today, I'm speaking with Dr. Arturo Casadevall, who told us several months ago about the innovative idea of using plasma from patients who have recovered from COVID-19 to help others. Well, a lot has happened since then. Let's listen. Dr. Casadevall, thank you for joining me again. When we spoke a few months ago, you were explaining the potential value of convalescent serum for patients with the novel coronavirus. Could you explain what that is all about one more time?
Right. So this convalescent plasma therapy is the use of plasma, and plasma is the liquid part of the blood, the part that doesn't have all the red cells, the white cells, for treatment of infectious diseases. So the way it works is simple. People who recover from COVID-19, after a few weeks, can donate their plasma. And this plasma can then be tested for antibodies. The plasma has antibodies that kill the virus. And that this plasma can be used to treat the disease in people who have it.
Now, when we spoke, that was just a theory. What's happened since then to that theory?
Well, a lot of good things have happened. Plasma is now being used throughout the world. Many countries are using it. They differ on how they use it. Some countries are doing randomized clinical trials. Others are using it directly on patients. Here in the United States, we are doing both. We have randomized clinical trials to look for efficacy. That's when you compare the use of plasma versus a control. But we also have a mechanism by which sick people can obtain plasma because of a high likelihood of usefulness. And so far, 35,000 people have been treated in the United States.
Wow. Now, could you explain the clinical situation where this would be potentially used? Is it just for people who are very, very sick, or where does it fit in the spectrum?
Actually, when this all began, when the first use began in the beginning of April, most of the plasma was being used in very ill patients. But in reality, antibody therapies, plasma therapies, work best when given early. So the emerging evidence is that when people receive plasma before they have a respiratory decompensation, before they get very sick, that's when they do best and it works best.
Now, has there been data published yet to see whether this works, or is it just a hunch that people are following?
Yeah. So the data so when we talk about plasma, there are two parts of this. One of them is safety and the other one is efficacy. Let's cover safety first. Back when we started in March and April, there was always the concern that you're doing something new. You never know how a new disease is going to respond to plasma. The good thing I can say to you is that two studies have now been published involving 20,000 patients, and they show that plasma is relatively safe. It doesn't have any signatures of toxicity that we would worry about. So I think safety, we know a lot, and it's very encouraging and reassuring. As to efficacy, well, we are beginning to see the several results have now been published. There has been at least one randomized controlled trial done in China in which had to be stopped prematurely because they ran out of patients. But with the data that they have, was very encouraging that people who got it early responded with improvement. There has been another randomized clinical trial from Iraq showing that it reduced mortality. There are several case series with controls now from the United States and Italy and other countries. And the story is consistent. That is, all the information that we have is that if used early, is associated with a reduction in mortality.
Now, are there additional studies still ongoing, and what will those studies demonstrate?
Absolutely. So, Josh, if you asked me in March and April, is this going to work? I would have said to you, maybe. If you asked me in May, I would have said possibly in June. Today, what I would say to you is probably. But I won't say to you definitively. And the reason for that is because to be able to say the word definitively, it definitively works, you need a level of knowledge and rigor that can only come from randomized clinical trials. And those are ongoing. There are several going in the United States and in Europe, and we are hopeful that that data will be available soon. Here at Hopkins, there are two major trials going on. There are multi-center trials. One is led by Shmuel Shoham, and it's looking at prophylaxis. That is, if you have a situation where someone has a major exposure to the virus, like, for example, a first responder, a breakdown in personal protective equipment, and you give them plasma, do you prevent disease? And the second one...
Before you go to the second one, what would make you think that that might work, giving someone plasma before they even show symptoms?
Because the history is that antibody always works best when given early. If you give antibody early, the antibody will kill the virus. And very early in infection, there are very few viruses around. So if you had antibody, the expectation based on everything we know is that that would work much better than in therapy.
Got it. Now, tell me about the second study that Hopkins is involved in.
The second study looks at very early treatment. Most of the people today that have COVID-19 are at home, and the majority of them get better. But not everybody gets better. Some of them continue to have difficulty in short express and have to go to the hospital. So this study is being led by David Sullivan of the School of Public Health. And what you're looking at is whether if you take somebody who's at home and you give them one unit of plasma, do you change the outcome of the disease? In other words, the endpoint is hospitalization. And if this works, and we are very hopeful, given all we know, that this will has a high likelihood of working, this will be a major advance, because if you can keep people out of the hospital, you certainly would keep them out of the ICU for sure, and their recovery will be much more rapid.
So can you just take us a little bit behind the scenes? What's it like to be running two big trials like this in the middle of a pandemic?
So what does it entail to do a clinical trial like this? First, you need to identify the individuals. You need to talk to them. You need to consent them. Remember, this is a randomized, double-blind, controlled trial. What that means is that either the doctor or the patient knows whether they're getting plasma or they're getting plasma before the epidemic, one that doesn't have the antibodies. Then once this person agrees, these persons are infectious, so you need to bring them to a site in which they can be transfused. You need to arrange transportation. You need to arrange for their care. You need to observe them. And then when they go back home, you're going to need to follow up every day to see how they're doing. So you can imagine the enormous amount of work that is involved.
It's probably dozens of people at different levels, from the research team all the way down to the local level.
Exactly. So you need all that data coordination. There is also a data safety monitoring board. What does that mean? Well, there are people who can see what's going on. They're not blind into the data, because if there is any effects, positive or negative, the data safety monitoring board can stop the study. So we have received a $35 million grant, Hopkins, when I say we, I say Hopkins, to expedite the studies. And the money is being used in getting more sites on board, because it is so labor intensive to do a few patients that the best way to do this is to get a lot of sites who can bring in patients. The more sites you bring in across the states, the more patients you have. And once you reach a critical number, then hopefully we would have an answer.
Well, I appreciate your walking through some of those details. I think people, including myself, don't always appreciate just how much work goes into these studies and how many people are really devoted to scientific investigation to figure out what can save lives.
Right. I think one of the frustrations with people is when they say, well, what don't we know already? It just takes time to do something like this, even when people are working exclusively on the problem.
Yeah. I want to ask you about the relevance of the work that's going on for a coronavirus vaccine. Is it a good sign that the plasma so far has been safe for the safety of the vaccine? Is it a good sign that there is evidence of effectiveness for the effectiveness of the vaccine? How do you think about that? I know you are an immunologist and vaccine expert.
So the answer is yes, Josh. In fact, it is really good news that the plasma effort is working, because that not only informs a vaccine with efficacy, but in safety. Look, before we got into this, there was always the concern that some antibodies could be bad for you. And this is complicated immunology. So let's just say that occasionally one makes antibodies that make disease worse. And we did not know really how this virus was going to interact with the immune system. But what we know today is that most people who recovered have good antibodies in their blood. And that's coming largely from the studies that are going on associated with the plasma. And we know now all the indicators are that when you transfer those antibodies to a person that has COVID, that you get a beneficial result. So the reason this is very important for vaccine design is twofold. One, it suggests that the antibodies that are elicited to COVID-19 are good. And the other thing is that the plasma efforts show you and inform you how much antibody you may need to make to be protected. So the plasma projects are generating information that will inform everything that follows, from vaccine design to monoclonal antibodies to other antibody therapies.
Got it. Well, that is extremely helpful. My last question, I wanted just maybe to follow up on this idea of monoclonal antibodies. So there are other kind of antibody therapies. Can you just explain what that is and how that's connected to the work that you've been doing?
Right. So when you get COVID-19 and you recover, you mount many different types of antibodies. Your blood is like very diverse with types of antibodies. Some of them are great. Some of them are good. Some of them are duds. So one of the things that can be done with today's technology is you can find the cells that are making those antibodies, and you can get them into a laboratory and help them make antibodies for you. And these cells make monoclonal antibodies. So a monoclonal antibody is different from convalescent plasma in that it is a single antibody. It is not a mixture anymore.
It's not diverse.
Exactly. So if you have a protective antibody, then you can make a lot of it. And then you can have a preparation where all the antibodies are the same. And this has huge advantages in therapy because it becomes a defined product. Currently, plasma varies from person to person, and it's very hard to standardize. So monoclonal antibodies, possibly in combinations, could be major resources, therapeutic resources down the line. One of the issues is that it's going to take a while to ramp up production. It just takes a while to make enough antibody to treat people. And it's possible that those therapies will be significantly more expensive. Plasma is currently pretty cheap. One unit of plasma is a couple of $100s.
Got it.
Whereas antibody therapies may be significantly more expensive.
Well, this has been fantastic, explaining where we are with convalescent plasma, also explaining the research that's going on, the relevance for vaccines, the relevance for monoclonal antibodies. Thanks for all the time you've spent with me and our listeners. And just in general, Dr. Casadevall, thank you so much for your incredible work and devotion to this issue and the care of many, many patients over the last few months.
So, Josh, I just want to say the credit for all of this is the thousands of people who have mobilized in these grassroots movements to bring antibody therapies in the form of convalescent plasma. I'm happy to return. We anticipate that there is going to be a lot of news in the next few weeks regarding efficacy, regarding actions of the FDA. So one phone call away, and I'm happy to chat again.
Thanks very much, Dr. Casadevall.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.